Hello and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Baldur's Gate. Today I'll be reading History of Dambrath, which I found right here in Entar Silvershield's estate in northwest Baldur's Gate. History of Dambrath. The nation of Dambrath was formed out of a barbarian kingdom almost a half millennium ago by a powerful alliance of priestesses of Loviatar and the Drow from the city of Talindet. In 211 DR, fleeing from the destruction of the homeland by the then great kingdoms of Unther and Mullarand, four tribes of barbarians entered Dambrath. They found a coast where the dolphins danced and plains where the grass was long. They roamed from the borders of the walls of Harua as far east as the current borders of Estigund. They soon became known as the Achaean, or People of the Wind. In 545 DR, a great war chief, Reinar, arose to lead the tribes. The halflings of Lurin were quickly enslaved, and several of the coastal cities of Durpar were captured or razed. Estigund fell to his rule, and eventually Reinar turned his attention to Halrua. An army of 40,000 horsemen and a fleet of 50 ships mounted a coordinated attack, and even though Reinar was able to get beyond the walls of Harua and occupy the cities of Mithel, Galdel, and Zalsu, their magics proved to be more than a match for the invaders. Reinar was finally defeated in a great battle at Sulazir by the Archmage Mycantil and his troop of wizards. Reinar's son, Reinar II, took command of the army and set out on a two-month overland retreat. He arrived home with 1,000 surviving fighting men and no shaman. Reinar II proved to be as good a ruler in defeat as his father was in war. He consolidated his forces and pulled home almost all of his troops, and he knew that the defeat made them tempting prey for raiders and encroaching monsters. This action allowed for the safe development of his peoples. By the time the ninth Reinar was king in 802 DR, the Arkuans were fat and lazy. Reinar the ninth, or Reinar the Foolish, as he is more commonly known, insisted on expanding his nation to gain more gold to finance his military campaigns. He ordered the mining of many rich loads of silver and electrum in the Nolwatch Mountains, but before his plans of expansion could begin, the miners encountered the Drow of Talindur. The Drow were outraged and began a steady series of raids and attacks on the Achaean strongholds. Whole villages were destroyed overnight, and no trace of the invaders could be found. Reinar IX committed the foolhardy action of attacking the Drow in retaliation. While the Achaeans managed to get a force into the Drow city, this action only succeeded in uniting the normally chaotic Drow. For once, the full power of a Drow city was turned against an enemy. The battle quickly moved back to the surface. Reinhar's raiders were wiped out, leaving Reinar with only a small portion of his original military. This was not enough for the Drow, who demanded total enslavement of the entire surface nation. The Achaeans resisted valiantly, and the war went on for 3 decades at tremendous cost in life to both sides. Finally, the Drow had the Achaean forces cornered at Maldur. Almost without hope, the defenders are overjoyed when a group of half-elven pilgrims appeared on the scene. The High Priestess Kethir Shintar offered the aid of her clerics to help defend the city, and Reinar took this to be an omen from the gods. A priestess was placed with almost every company. Within a 10-day, the Drow struck. The priestesses did indeed prove to be of great aid, but to the Drow. Every priestess turned on the Achaeans, and Kethir herself slew Reinar. The Drow were still weakened by the battle, and only the presence of the priestesses enabled them to win. Kethir, realizing the unique advantage she possessed, made a deal that even the suspicious Drow embraced. Her priestesses would rule the land, and in exchange they would provide access to the surface for the Drow, trading weapons, slaves, and supplies. The Drow were delighted with this brazen offer from a surface dweller. Reinar had been slain and the insult avenged, and after 30 years of war, the Drow were not particularly interested in Dambrath. They did insist, however, on taking the best captured males as slaves. Kethir quickly agreed to this, seeing the males as an obstacle to her own power. Kethir ruled for 205 years. She fulfilled her promise to make Dambrath, or the Nation of Pain, a bastion of evil in the realms. In her time, Kathira saw the priesthood of Loviatar expand to thousands, and faith in the Beast Lords previously worshipped by the Archaeans were nearly eradicated. Many of the Archaeans were able to escape their new mistresses and flee to the Swagdar. There they resumed their almost forgotten nomadic life. The priestesses of Loviatar continued to enjoy good relations with the Drow, and some even took mates, creating a race of Drow half-elves. These dark half-elves became known as the Krintri, or Noble Ones. Most are priestesses of Loviatar, though many are mages as well. They consolidated their power, learning much of the area from the Shabali, or Lower Ones, as the Archaeans are now called. The capital of Dambrath was established at Kathir, built after Kathir's passing and named in her honor. Her death came at the hands of her daughter, Felina, who had grown tired of waiting for her mother to die. Felina ruled for only 5 years, however, before her own daughter, Kathake, assumed the role in the same fashion. Kathake ruled for 54 years, eventually falling in battle against the Gold Dragon. She died childless, and her niece, Melanith, assumed the throne. Melanith faced an increasing population and unrest among males who longed for a return to their prestige of old. Melanith did not return their previous status, but she did make use of them. Fearing that the great nations of Mullarand and Unther might rise again, she decided that mundane tasks, such as defense of the kingdom, would be handled by men. She was the first to name a male to the post of war chief. Sadalar, a Krintri, became the queen's consort. His term as war chief was characterized by widespread bribery and corruption. He was, however, responsible for getting many privileges returned to the Archaeans. After Melanith's rule, the Shabali were considered second-class citizens rather than slaves. Though males were granted more power during her rule, Melanith also solidified the split between the sexes. While the rulers of Dambrath had been females for over 2 centuries, it was more because of competence than gender. Melanith, however, decreed that men could have no authority except over other men. The female-led hierarchy of Loviatar was quick to back this move. Many of the bravest and best men of the kingdom perished in raids on Estigund, Durpar, the bandit tribes of Veldorn, and against the Noles that had returned to the Nolwatch Mountains. Some even fought at the side of the Drow in their battle with the Sferf Neblin city of Aventine. The Deep Gnomes were destroyed, but so were the Shabali. The Drow and the Krintri were largely unharmed, and for their aid, the Krintri were rewarded with a number of Drow males to breed into their race. Melanith took a Drow male as her consort to replace Sadalar, who had perished in the conflict. The Drow, Nim Inthig, fathered 3 daughters and a son. It was at this time that Melanith began the isolationist policy that Dambrath still follows today. Melanith ruled for 156 years, her daughter, Ossetil, for 125. The current queen of Dambrath, Yanandra, who is known in Dambrath as the Pirate Queen, is said to have sailed as far south as Zakara on pillaging raids. Yanandra has been ruling for 71 years and is beginning to show signs of age. She has 3 daughters as well, named Lorathirin, Melchoril, and Hassifir. While she does remain extremely popular, especially to the Krintri, the children of leaders in this land are not known to patiently wait their turn. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Baldur's Gate, History of Dambrath.